Thank you for the introduction. You were quite positive. I will try to make it an interesting presentation. I will do my utmost to achieve that. Again, welcome. I hope for a somewhat bigger audience, but as I already said to my introducer, it might also have to do with our technology. We are 80 years in the electroforming business, but it's still quite an unknown technology. Together with photo etching, electroforming is quite an unknown technology. So I will try to change that this afternoon. I made a short agenda, so the intention of this presentation, then the introduction to the electroforming process, electroforming in the world of micromanufacturing, and then some examples of electroform products. Something about automation, and especially based on the inspection we're doing, and then at the end there should be some time for questions or even discussions. My intention of this presentation, explain that electroforming is an additive manufacturing process, growing atom by atom, and we all know additive manufacturing is very popular at this moment due to the 3D printing. I come back on that later. And then I will introduce not especially young one, but engineers for electroforming technology. As I already explained, it's still a quite unknown technology. And make you aware that electroforming is able to make high volume production with micron tolerances. Here you can already see an example. This is an example of a shaver foil. Shaver foils are made annually 100 million pieces per year. At Fico in the Netherlands, we produce 30 million of them, and we do it with only two persons. And what I mean to say is that it's a quite mature technology, and you can really make high volume with micron tolerances. This one is not that critical. We make them on square meter mandrels. Typical tolerances here are plus minus 5, plus minus 10. But again, you can make them in very easy and very high volumes. And also show you some nice animations, and with the invitation, if you like them, to do your next development together with us, with Fico. The process itself, additive manufacturing, building your material atom by atom. So in fact, we don't make holes, but we make the material around the holes. Of course, we do sell holes, but we make the material around the holes. We start with a metal substrate, metal or glass, depends on what kind of product and what the requirements are. It has to be conductive, so if it's glass, you have to coat it with a metal or whatever. You have to coat it with a metal, sorry. Then we apply a coating, a light sensitive coating. It can be a dry resist, can be a very thin positive resist. I will get back on that later. Then we expose the photoresist, and you get a mandrel with conductive and non. This is the non-conductive. This is the photo, and this is the conductive area. Then you can deposit nickel, copper, or some kind of alloy, what you want, and then you can electroform the pattern. And this animation already shows two type of patterns. We can grow over the resist, and we can grow between the resist. But I come back on that later. And after stripping the photoresist, we can easily harvest the product and. In fact, we have nearly totally freedom of design. You can make anything. So this is how it looks in practice. I won't read all the text again, but again, additive manufacturing, atom by atom. So we have nickel pellets in the solution. That's the anode. You apply a current, and then the nickel will deposit at the cathode, electroforming any product or any shape you want. As I already said with the previous slide, we have two types of electroforming. We have the what we call plating defined. What you see here is this yellow line, that's the photoresist. When we start electroforming, the nickel builds over the photoresist. And here you can see that's a completely isotropic process. So the thickness is exactly the same distance as this one. So with this process, we have to be very accurate on the thickness. Why? For example, here you see an inkjet nozzle plate. In these inkjets, we have to produce them in high volumes within plus minus 1 micron. That means the thickness is coming from both sides, so the thickness has to be within a half micron accurate over a substrate of 30-30 or even up to square meter, but this one typically is made on substrate size 30-30. Because the hole size depends on the thickness of the metal deposited, we call it plating defined. So the plating bath affects at the end the hole size that you can make, that you can grow. this is what we call photo-defined. Here we have a very thick photoresist, and in fact what we do is we grow the nickel also between the photoresist. These are the typical hole shapes you're making with this thick resist. And this is called photo-defined or lithographic-defined because you become independent from your plating solution. It doesn't matter if you make a micron less or more, it doesn't matter, the hole size will be exactly the same, and that's why we call it photo-defined. Surface replication is also possible, so not a thick or thin material, but the previous speaker, Max Groenendijk, he was talking about making all kind of surfaces. Recently we had some projects with him, so if you can make a structure, micro nano structures with his laser, with his pico and femtosecond laser, we can very easily transfer it in the positive or the negative, build a family of it, scale it up, and yeah, even the smallest details up to square meter size can be replicated rather easily and used as a mold for further industrialization. Yeah, visual tour through the process. I want to go through this one very fast because I also have an animation. We have to prepare the substrate, can be metal, can be glass. We apply a photoresist, in this case it's laminate, it's a dry photoresist, but we can also apply a wet resist. Then we do the photo imaging. In the past it was done with Mylar artwork, if it's very accurate, for example for inkjet production we use glass tooling, but more and more we switch to laser direct imaging, meaning that you can directly write into your photoresist. After that the resist is developed. Put it in the reactor forming bath, and here you can see the typically overgrowth, the plating defined, and this is the photo defined. So this is done with thick resist. And after stripping the photo resist, we can easily peel off the products and make thousands or millions of products, whatever we want. So this is the animation of the whole process. That was the substrate preparation, then we can apply a photoresist, dry resist, to the exposure with a laser direct imager. Then the photoresist is developed. Substrate is taken to the electro forming bath. Again, the two types of electric form we can do overgrow. Then the photoresist is removed, and if you do it in the correct way, the products won't stick to your mandrel. You can easily pell them off and harvest them. Yeah, it depends on how accurate we have to be. Let's say plus minus 1 we do on 30 by 30, plus minus 3, 50 by 60 centimeters. And plus minus 5, plus minus 10 we have mandrels up to 1.5 by 1.5 meter, which enables us to make millions and millions of products. For example, an encoder disc with slits of 30 microns. Nebulized for drug simulation, 2 micron holes, 16 micron thick, and here again an inkjet nozzle plate with holes of 15 micron. And again, we have totally freedom of design. I think we have more than 1400 active customers annually. Again, additive manufacturing, high aspect ratio. For example, the nebulizer you saw for the drug simulation, it has a 2 micron hole and it has 60 micron thickness. That's what we mean with high aspect ratio. You can't achieve that with etching. You can do it with laser, but I come back on that later. It's too slow. Accurate hole size, not only accurate, but also if we pump a 10 micron hole, you get a 10 micron hole. So also for filtration, that's very important. if we promise you a 10 micron hole, you should have a 10 micron hole to do an absolute filtration and not to do an in-depth filtration where you can use, let's say, 2 to 20 microns. But if we say 10 micron, it will be 10 micron. Micron size holes, non-clogging holes, I will also get back on that later. We have three core technologies, electroforming, photoetching and laser cutting. Today I want to focus on the electroforming. Advantages of the electroforming are that you can make huge quantities of products with both technologies, but with the electroforming technology you can very easily achieve tolerances up to 10 times better than with photoetching. Sometimes the material properties can be adjusted to the customer needs. For example, the nebulized, they have to be biocompatible, then we work with palladium, nickel, these type of things. Same story for laser cutting. Laser cutting is evolving very fast, especially the pico and the femtosecond lasers, and especially in the area where we are, in the micron area. But it's still far too slow, and with electroforming it doesn't matter. If you make one hole or you make 1,000 or even 1,000,000 holes, you all do it in the same time. But I have to be honest, I said material properties can be adjusted to the customer needs, but I have to be honest, with photo etching and with laser cutting you have more freedom to choose your material. With electroforming it's mainly nickel or copper and its alloys. Electroforming in additive manufacturing, very popular, do the 3D printing. Here you can see General Electric a fuel nozzle. It's also made by additive manufacturing. They were quite successful with this part, and in 2020 they are about to produce 45,000 of these fuel nozzles. What we do is also additive manufacturing, but it's not as 3D as this one is, but we can make very nice products. I thought we could.
Introducing machines of incredible complexity, designed to exacting precision, and created without assembly. Machines of unparalleled performance and unprecedented scale. Welcome to the genesis of micro machines. This extraordinary process begins with a 3D CAD model. Using proprietary software, the model is divided into layers, allowing photo masks to be generated to submicron accuracy, with hundreds to even thousands of devices fitting on a single ceramic wafer. A custom photolithography process defines a pattern where the first layer of structural metal is deposited at the atomic level through electrodeposition. The photoresist is then dissolved, and sacrificial metal is deposited over the structural material. The surface is then planarized to a consistent uniform thickness, within a tolerance of 2 microns. The process is repeated for each layer in the design, defining a new standard for the creation of complex mechanisms. The sacrificial metal is then abstracted through a chemical etching process, simultaneously enabling movement of each mechanism while releasing the device from the wafer. High-performance micro machines and precision parts, enabling new solutions in medical, semiconductors, and aerospace.
I did put this animation in, I have to be honest with you, it's not something we do at FAIC or at Airbag, but I want to show you the atomic additive manufacturing layer by layer. As we all know how it's done by layers, you can also do it with electroforming. There are companies in the world doing it. If you're interested, please contact me and I will get you in contact with these people. But I only want to show you in that previous movie that you can do also the layer by layer manufacturing and make moving parts also by electroforming. Some product examples we are currently producing. This is a mold for making hooks in a composite material. These pillars, they are made for cleaning purposes. We can, this is only 100 micron, but we can make it on square meter. This is in fact currently the smallest product we are making. It has a diameter of 15 micron. The slit is about 6 to 7 microns. So you can imagine if you have a substrate 30 by 30, you have millions and millions of products. But on the other hand, we make very small products. This is done in a clean room, let's say class 100. But we can also make products on 1.5 by 1.5 meter. Here is a typical example. It's a screen to filter the sugar crystals out of the molasses, and I think in Eerbeek we produce about 200 square meters of these. All kinds of other applications. I want to start with this one. It's a measurement equipment to measure sensors in autonomous driving cars. And to these sensors here on the tips, we can put all kind of features on top of it. And these features, they should make contact with the solder balls on the chip to enable to measure the chips into an autonomous driving car. Here you can also see all kind of tips. And this is a typical one. It presses into the solder ball, so you're able to measure the function of a part. Some other examples. Inkjet is a very industrial inkjet, also used for 3D printing, especially the industrial ones. It's an important market for us. Nozzle diameters 15 to 60, it's more 15 to 40. More and more they get to 15 microns, and the tolerance is plus minus 1. But if you go to 15 micron hole size, plus minus 1 is not enough anymore. We make them in very big quantities. And why do people like these electroform parts? As you can see here, the hole is very symmetrical. And this is a cross-section of an electroformed hole. Here you can also see that we have, in this case, applied a gold plating. It's more and more changed into palladium nickel because it's cheaper and it's easier to apply. But in this one there was a gold plating. But what the inkjet customers, what they like is that the hole is very symmetrical and you get a superior yet straightness. The big ones, let's say the Ricohs, the Seikos, the Konica, Minolta, Xeras, Canon, Fuji, they all are working with electroformed nozzle plates, or they want to go back to the electroformed nozzle plates just because of the superior yet straightness. There's also another discussion to it. It's the metal is quite rigid, and they can, with their piezo, they can get into higher frequencies due to the richness of this nickel product. Nebulizer plates, I mentioned them quite often already. Hole sizes down to 2 microns, 60 micron thick products. Biocompatible, in this case we made them in palladium nickel. We do not only make them for the drugs inhalation, also for perfumes, pesticides, humidifiers, whatever, but this one is for the medical industry.
Our unique palladium vibrating mesh technology is a breakthrough in aerosol drug delivery and is at the heart of all our products. And unlike traditional small volume nebulizers, both the Aerogen Solo and the Aerogen Ultra are virtually silent in use. The central aperture plate is just 5 millimeters in diameter and perforated with 1,000 precision formed holes. This vibrates 128,000 times per second, creating a mini pump that produces a fine particle mist of uniform size droplets, each between 1 and 5 microns in diameter, an ideal particle size for deep lung penetration. Clinical studies have shown that this results in deposition rates far greater than can be achieved by conventional nebulization. Both the Aerogen Solo and the Aerogen Ultra offer incredible versatility, confirming Aerogen's commitment to a new era of high-performance aerosol drug delivery throughout the hospital environment.
Here it's very important that these holes are about 2 microns. The droplets which it releases are 4 to 6 microns. And that means that the drug directly disappears into your body. If they are too big, if they're bigger than 8 to 10 microns, they will condensate in your lungs. And then the positive effect of the nebulizer is gone, because the positive effect is that you need, let's say, 5 to 10% of the drugs you would normally need when you take it oral. And it's not because of costs or anything, but it's just because of the side effect of these medicines. If you can use 5 or 10%, you don't have all the negative side effects of these drugs. Test contactless, also very fast growing market. I already mentioned the autonomous driving car. There are coming more and more sensors into these cars. They all have to be measured. And also these contactors, they are very small, on 30 by 30 centimeters. There are about 30 to 40,000 of these contactors on it. And they are used to make contact between a printed circuit board and a solder ball from the processors, so which enables us to, yeah, not us, but our customer to measure these sensors. Also here, very many different designs, high volume production, millions and millions, all different types. This one is milled, but this one is electroformed. This is one we are currently making. And again, we can apply all kind of tips or features or whatever we want, because we have rather freedom of design in our products. I think automation and inspection, of course, we want to automate as much as possible, especially in the larger series, but so also in the production you already saw, but I think here we really make the difference with our competitors. If you promise to make an inkjet with an all size plus minus one, you must also be able to measure it. So we do measure these products really 24/7, even over the weekend. This machine is running, I will show it later in an animation. Data management is an integral part of supply. That means that all the data are stored and are sent with the product to our customer. So his pick and place machine knows exactly where the rejects are and they will take them out. And at the end, for the nebulizers, we can do punching, doming, function test and packaging all in one machine, completely automated and no one involved. This is an animation and I think it starts quite bad. I was talking about automation and it starts with hand automation, but with manual inspection, but please. So this is the robot I was talking about. These sheets are 30 by 30 centimeters, several hundred thousand holes in it, and it will take him with 100,000 holes, it will take half an hour to three quarter of an hour for a sheet to have it completely measured and have the data stored. Encoder this. Here we don't measure, we punch them out, and after that we do a function test. We know what signal the customer wants to get from his product, and we don't measure it, but we do a function test. They are completely 100% tested on function. So here you can see the function test. And it will decide okay or not okay, and will be shipped to the customer. Service inspection is something we at this moment do at a small scale. Each individual part has a barcode in it, so we know exactly what is measured and which part is measured and where it comes from, when it has been made. We do it just on small scale. We are learning on it, but within a half year we will be able to do it on sheets from 50 by 60 centimeters, so each dust particle or whatever will be removed or rejected automatically. This is a typical inkjet, surface of such an inkjet. And here is the tape and reel machine I already mentioned. So the hole size measurement, the doming, the punching, measuring the dome height, and at the end package them in tape and reel is all done completely automatic in one machine. That was my presentation. Questions? Please.
thanks for a nice talk. So, any questions?